practice of virtue and to pay particular attention to their domestic concern should also be a special object of their attention. The wife should love to remain at home unless compelled by necessity to go out, and she should never presume to leave home without her husband's consent. Again, and in the conjugal union chiefly consists, let wives never forget that next to God, they are to love their husband, to esteem them above all others, yielding to them in all things not inconsistent but Christian piety, a willing and ready obedience. Our God, created heaven, so to avoid all disordinate affection, selfishness, said ten, which is a destruction of love, self-love. The faults of temperament which have not been corrected. This is why you see spiritual life is of essence and so important for the good of the family and a happy marriage. Examination of conscience, retreat, frequent confession, the spouses sanctify themselves, correct their fault, and can really practice sacrificing them to make the life of their spouses easy, comfortable, enjoyable. If someone is choleric, impatient, you'll see whatever selfish and don't correct. Maybe we have a tendency to be choleric, to impatient. But if it is not corrected and there is not a will to correct this fault, and this importance precisely is the grace of receiving frequently the sacrament to help the nature to correct a fault of temperament of nature. We have to take consciousness of that and not accept it, oh, I am like that, I cannot help. That's wrong. You make the life of your spouse and of your family miserable because you don't accept, you see your own fault. Without sin, and it could be serious sin. If there is no sufficient reason to refuse, could be sufficient reason to refuse the conjugal wife, which has been promised at the day. But if it is refused out of precisely selfishness, laziness, lack of spirit of sacrifice sometimes, it cannot be excuse of sin and sometimes mortal sin because it is the law and will of God. That by this also mutual exchange of the conjugal wife, the common yoke, literally what that means. So we are bent bound to carry the same yoke together until life, until death depart. And so to refuse and to break the yoke and the law of the conjugal duty is a serious sin. You have to remind the parents and the spouse sometimes not to neglect it, because it is how, precisely when this is refused, and especially it could be with a mutual consent by the spouses to agree to remain chaste for a period of time, that's just for sacrifice for Lent, for Holy Week, or something. Fine, but St. Paul warns the spouses, it's not to be too long, lest the devil come and tempt you. And this temptation could be simply the first step, a diminution of the ritual, of the fervor, of the zeal, you see, the enthusiasm to love and serve and dedicate sacrifices for our spouses that we must consider the catechism to have for him to esteem our spouse above all others. Spouse must esteem, a mutual esteem of their spouse above all others. And so everything which could be, just, you see, the devil is smart. He begins by little things to start with. And if you could manage to diminish in the mind, in the heart of one of the spouse, a little bit of esteem for his spouse, for the devil is a big victory. Watch. Because he knows that if he manages to make you suddenly become judgmental, you know, and depreciating the esteem you have is the beginning of the fall. You can fall. Then the beginning of the lack of spirit of sacrifice. But what the point to sacrifice oneself for someone to whom we have no esteem? And so the sacrifice, the spirit of sacrifice will diminish. No, the love will diminish, because this is love. So this mutual esteem towards one another must be preserved highly in the mind, in the heart of the spouses, to foster the spirit of sacrifice, and thus the mutual love. This will be for the joy and the peace of the family, for the happiness of the spouse, and thus, of course, for the children who will benefit this close union of the two hearts, of the two souls, of